Hello, everyone. Welcome. Just going to make sure you can see me here. My name is Michelle Massey. I am the Director of Public Programs at the Museum of Russian Art, and it is our pleasure to welcome you to today's program, a virtual discussion with author Vladimir Alexandrov about his book, The Black Russian. February is Black History Month here in the United States, and this is a really, I think, a wonderful opportunity to delve into a discussion about this man's extraordinary life and the history and the cultures that surrounded his existence. So I'd like to, before we get too far, I want to put out a special thanks to our co-sponsors of today's program. First of all, Russian American Jews of Minnesota, RAJMN, and St. Paul Jewish Federation. It's a pleasure to be able to co-present this program and bring in all of our audiences together. I'd like to also give special thanks to Ilana Volodarsky, who helped connect all of us together and is a wonderful colleague. So you'll see behind me a clear gallery. This is the museum right behind me here. It's not very often that you see no art on the walls. And I want to mention that because we are in the midst of a transformation right now. We are opening three exhibitions this month, which is very exciting. We opened the first of those three last Saturday, which is our new permanent collection gallery. This Saturday, we will be opening our main gallery with Ekaterina Kroman, The Art of Synergism. And then we will be opening on the 27th, the next Saturday, an exhibition in the Mezzanine Gallery on the paintings of Geli Korshev. So it's going to be a wonderful time. You know, the 27th is when you can see the entire gallery open, but we also, we're open right now in this transition. And we also have a wonderful exhibition by Marlena Miles, which is Russian Colonialism in Alaska. That's in our Fireside Gallery. So with that, you are welcome to ask questions today using our chat function. You can go to the bottom of your screen. Any of your chats are going to be able to be seen only by the panelists. So feel free, we'll get to the questions right at the end of our program. This session is going to be recorded and will be available on our website as well. So that's all the housekeeping. With that, let's get our program started. I'm going to introduce you to our chief curator and head of exhibitions and collections here at the Museum of Russian Art. Here to begin and introduce our author and be in conversation with him today, please welcome Dr. Masha Zavialova.
Greetings, everyone. Today it is my pleasure to introduce my fellow Russian author, Vladimir Alexandrov, with his book, The Black Russian. Vladimir Alexandrov received his PhD from Princeton in Russian in comparative literature. He worked at Harvard, taught Russian literature and culture. Then he taught at Yale, and now he is Professor Emeritus of Yale University. He published widely on various aspects of Russian culture and literature until he discovered the fascinating figure, historical figure of Frederick Thomas. And my first question to Professor Alexandrov is about the origin of that book and how on earth he could discover that fairly obscure historical figure and begin to explore and research around this person.
Thank you, Masha. It's a pleasure to be here. And I'm glad you asked me that question because it brings me back to a moment that changed my life. As you mentioned, I used to teach Russian literature and culture, and I was preparing a class on interwar Russian culture and wanted to include a singer who was very popular at the end of the late imperial period in the 1920s, Alexander Virtinsky, still popular to this day. And I was reading his memoirs, and he mentioned that when he landed in Constantinople, where he went to escape the Bolsheviks in the south of Russia. He began to perform, as he wrote in Russian, but I'll translate it, for our famous Moscow Negro, Fyodor Fyodorovich Thomas, the owner of the famous Maxim in Moscow. Now that phrase, that sentence, so surprised me that I remember I closed the book and put it down. I knew something about Russian culture of the time. I'd never heard of famous Black people in Russia at that time. And of course, if you ask any reasonably well-educated Russian to name a famous Black person in Russian history, they'll name Abram Ganibal, Pushkin's ancestor, the ancestor of Russia's national writer. So anyway, I was intrigued. I began to dig. And initially, it was very difficult to find anything about him, even in Yale's very rich libraries. But then I began to travel to archives. I wound up traveling to 5 countries over time. And I started to find a paper trail for this enigmatic Black Russian that Virtinsky started me off on. And I was able to find enough information about him to write the book.
Yeah, so actually that was one of my questions that I've been asking myself and will ask you, as I have to do a lot of research, and it's always the more obscure the topic is, the harder it is to find information. And so what are your sources, actually? Where did you go to find that much detail about this person?
I was fortunate in a way that my subject got into trouble. Because if you're in trouble with somebody, there's usually a paper trail. So Thomas, you know, I should just say perhaps in a sentence or two, the arc of his life. He was born to former slaves in Mississippi. He left the South for the American North, where of course he encountered racism at the end of the 19th century. He was born in 1872. He went to Europe at the end of the 19th century, encountered very little racism, if any, there. Wound up going to Russia in 1900. And in Russia, gradually he became, by raising himself up in his profession, which is to work in restaurants, from a waiter to a head waiter to the owner of fashionable places. When the Bolsheviks took over, he had to escape from them, and he went to Constantinople, where Virtinsky met him and performed for him. And that's where Thomas got into trouble. With whom? With American diplomats, because he tried to be recognized by them as an American, and they refused to recognize him as such for purely racist reasons. And this generated a lot of paperwork. And most of this paperwork was very carefully compiled and kept, and I found it in the National Archives outside of Washington, D.C. in College Park, Maryland. Another major source of information about Thomas, when he wasn't in trouble but merely successful, was in Russian theatrical journals of the time. And in the Leninka Library in Moscow, the main library of Moscow, I was able to find dozens of journals from the period about 1900 to 1918 that dealt with popular culture and theatrical life in Moscow. And I found a lot of information about Thomas there. I found information about Thomas in French diplomatic archives, because when he was successful in Moscow, his establishments performed a lot of French music, which raised copyright issues. And so this was reflected in correspondence between the French government and the Russian Copyright Agency. And then here and there in the most varied places, in the University of San Diego Library, I found a list of Americans who were in Constantinople in 1923, when the Turkish Republic was announced, and his name was there. So, mostly in very old publications and in some archives. In Moscow, I found things in various archives, including the archive that keeps old actual plans that were submitted to the city government before the revolution for approval, where there were sketches and blueprints of the rebuilding that he was engaged in, of the buildings that he had bought. So it is quite eclectic.
Yeah, so yeah, it seems like it's been a very extensive research that you've done on this person. And, you know, I'm also fascinated with the generally a topic of how people write biographies or autobiographies or biographies. So did you had to imagine some things and put something of your own visualization of this person and how he went through his life journey. So what I'm sure that it could help actually put this book into a film, which we will talk about later, but how much of your own imagination did you add to this story?
Well, you're right that you can't write a biography without that. And that was part of the pleasure and the challenge of writing this biography. I'm sure it's the same with any biography. How to be as scrupulously faithful to the facts as you can be, and at the same time, and this is where it gets tricky, to squeeze as much life out of them without betraying them or distorting them. And it was a constant constant tension. I wouldn't say it's a struggle because I knew I had to do it, so I wasn't resisting it. But every detail that I found, I tried to put into a context, I tried to visualize in a way that was relevant to it, to bring and the person's life to life. I didn't want to write a dry, academic kind of work. I mean, I was an academic myself for a long time. I value the kind of stuff that I did and that my colleagues do. But I wanted to be able to engage a reader who did not have an a priori interest in the material, which is what a lot of academics do. They write for the already involved profession. So that was the task. And there were times when I was tempted to make a slight digression towards something that was plausible, but that I did not know if it happened. There were times when I yielded to that, when I had some kind of reason for doing it. Most of the time I resisted it. I'll give you one concrete example. I wanted to give the reader a sense of what it was like growing up in this remote area of Mississippi in the 1870s and 80s. And I couldn't find anything by Thomas himself, but I found reminiscences by others who went through something like that. And I was able to borrow a few generic impressions that are very likely ones that Thomas also had. So that's what I did. But I resisted the temptations to embellish.
Yeah, but what you did, I think, actually added the warmth and the liveliness to the story. And that's why it is really very fun and easy to read. It flows really nicely because it's not just the facts, but also the you know, human emotion there, which is partly his and partly yours.
Yes, well, I'm glad you liked it.
Yeah, and I'm actually quite fascinated with the story of Frederick Thomas in Russia, and it's quite clear that he was, you know, he came from the south. Late 19th century, unlikely to really become a successful entrepreneur in America at that time. So he moved to Europe, then he came to Russia. And so what happened in Russia, how he became successful, and why did he flee the Bolsheviks? Why would not he want to continue in the Soviet Union? And what happened then in Turkey? That was an entirely different society. So actually Frederick Thomas moved through these three different, not just countries, but systems in a way, as far as race is concerned.
Yes, these are all important points. I'll try to be succinct because there's a lot to cover. Thomas arrived in Europe and then moved to Russia around 1900 with two saleable professions that he had learned in the United States. One was that he was a valet, and he had been a valet to a powerful businessman in Brooklyn before he went to Europe. The other profession, even more useful in a way, was that he was a waiter, and he was a very good waiter. I'll show later a slide relevant to this, but let me just say that he worked at a very high level as a waiter. And so he quickly found employment in Moscow, the city he chose to live in Russia, as a waiter. He quickly rose to the position of head waiter at an establishment. And just before he became an entrepreneur on his own, he became the assistant to one of the most successful restaurateurs in Moscow or the Russian Empire, the famous Sudakov, the owner of Yar, which was an institution in Moscow known for generations, a wonderful restaurant with entertainment. Thomas made so much money doing this kind of work, probably mostly from tips, because he's remembered as having been exceptionally good at welcoming well-heeled clients of the kind who would attend the places where he worked, that together with two Russians who also worked their way up in life, one had begun as a waiter as well, but as a Russian waiter, they pooled their money and they rented a failed entertainment garden in the center of Moscow, remnants of which still exist. It's the aquarium. They made a great success of it in a year. I remember using various charts, figuring out that each one of them netted $1 million in today's money in profit after their first successful year of running aquarium. Thomas reinvested his income. He opened a place on Bolshaya Dmitrovka Street. It's now the Nemirovich Danchenko, whatever it is, musical theater, I think number 17. It was a theater that had also failed that he took over and that he turned around and made into a great success. So by the time that the February, the first revolution of 1917 came, he was a very rich man. He bought a block of apartment buildings that still stand, although remodeled, that are diagonally across from the Hermitage Garden in central Moscow. And he had become a real major figure in Moscow's entertainment world. But when the Bolsheviks came, he survived the first February Revolution without too much trouble. When the Bolsheviks came, they didn't care that he had been an oppressed black man in the United States. They cared that he was a rich capitalist in pre-revolutionary Moscow. And so he became, for them, a class enemy. I mean, they saw things in as rigid a way as American racists did and do, in the sense that if you were once a capitalist, you're cursed with that for the rest of your life, in the same way that anybody who has any black blood is seen by racists as being black, in with all the opprobrium that carries for them. So he had to escape, because the only fate that he could await from the Bolsheviks when they took over was arrest and possible execution. So he fled. He fled in the summer of 1918 to the south, which was at the time occupied by the Germans, and thereby was free of the threat of the Bolsheviks. To extend this through another hectic period in his life very briefly, the Germans yielded the south of Russia to the French after the end of the Great War in 1918. There were hopes that the French would allow an anti-Bolshevik crusade to move north of the Black Sea shoreline and conquer the northern part of the country from the Bolsheviks. It didn't happen. The Bolsheviks took Odessa, which is where Thomas was at the time, and he had to flee again to Constantinople, which was a safe haven because it was under the Allies at the time. And that's where he started up his businesses from scratch. That's where Virzinski, the singer that I mentioned at the outset, performed for him. And after great difficulty, Thomas made a success of himself again. I don't know if you want me to get into the idea of how differently he was seen in these different settings. We can talk about that.
Yeah, absolutely. That's one thing that's really so interesting about his life story, his life journey, that, you know, he gets out of this American South, and generally a very racist society at that time, goes in to Europe and then to Russia, where, as you mentioned in your book, he found himself in a society that was colorblind in a way. What does it mean? Can you just unfold and develop that, the term?
Sure. Well, first of all, Black people of any kind from anywhere were very rare in Russia, whether it's from the Caribbean, Africa itself, or from the United States. I think that at the time that Thomas was flourishing in Moscow, the first decade and a half of the 20th century, in a city with a population of about 1.5 million people, there probably were no more than a dozen or two dozen Black people from anywhere in the world. So there was no a priori bias against Black people in Russia at the time. Moreover, Moscow in particular, as tourist guides of late imperial Russia describe it, was a very ethnically varied city. I mean, we have to remember that 2/3 of the Russian Empire lay in Asia, and Moscow was a crossroads between continents because of the importance that it had for trade in particular. So you could see people from Central Asia, from Asia, from the Black Sea area in Moscow all the time, which means that it was not the case that all eyes were round or all skin was white in Moscow. And this was reflected even as early as the early 1920s when Claude McKay, one of the first African-Americans to go to Soviet Russia, encountered a great curiosity in himself on the part of Russians because of his poetry, but no interest in him as a Black person. And when he asked, "Why aren't you concerned about my being Black?" the answer was basically what I had summarized. We're used to people having darker skin in Russia. It's not a big deal for us. So in other words, going from a racist society in the United States to a colorblind society to Russia was a very liberating experience for Thomas, and there were no obstacles to his being able to climb as high as his abilities allowed him and as the system allowed him, because of course it was hardly a heaven for everyone. But anyway, he became very successful in terms of business. Things changed again when he got to the Ottoman Empire, which it still was by the time he got there in 1919. The Turks did not divide the world according to criteria of race. They divided the world according to religion. So the Ottoman Empire was very tolerant in religious terms. It also was quite colorblind, so that there were Africans who occupied high positions in the Sultan's court. And if a Turk met someone like Thomas, the first question that he would have and that he might pose is, "Are you a Muslim or not?" And if Thomas was at least nominally a Christian, the issue of his skin color didn't make any difference, not to the indigenous population. It did, however, make a difference to the racist American diplomats with whom Thomas had to deal when he was in Constantinople. When he tried to get help from the American Consulate General in Constantinople, they treated him unfairly and resisted giving him any help for reasons that I can prove on the basis of documents were purely racist. So his life arc moves him through three very different ways of seeing and understanding the world. United States, Western Europe, and Russia were similar at the time, and then Turkey. The long arm of American racism caught up with Thomas in Constantinople and contributed to his eventual demise.
Yeah, that's a great story of a person who traveled through these three different systems that had different ways of looking at people. It's not just, you know, different countries or different cultures. They were structurally different as far as race was concerned. And he had to adapt to all of these societies. Like in one society, one part of him was visible and another part was invisible. And then he moves to a different society, a different system where all of that changes, and then to a third, not just two, but three different structures that he moved through.
Yes.
And now it would probably, it's a good time to put a face to the story. I know that you have some photographs of Frederick Thomas and his family. Could you share those?
I have a kind of a very selected series of images that I'll be happy to share and to talk about briefly to make all of this seem a little bit more real. The cover slide is so that you know about my website, which has a lot of information about Thomas that's not in the book and that we didn't get a chance to touch on today. So vialexandrov.com has a lot of information, especially in the blog. So Thomas came from a part of Mississippi known as the Delta. It's not the Delta where the Mississippi River dumps into the Gulf of Mexico. It's the floodplain of the Mississippi, several hundred miles north of the actual Delta. This is a stock photograph, which I wanted to include to give you a sense of the kind of incredible difficulty that had to be, the kind of labor that had to be expended to clear the land for planting. It was, of course, all done by slaves in Mississippi. The swamps had to be drained, the trees had to be cut down. The mortality rate among Black slaves in Mississippi was appalling. And this is the background of Thomas's parents, who survived their harrowing experience as slaves, and who in 1872 managed to buy a farm. Again, this is a stock photograph of what the purpose of all of that land clearing in Mississippi was. It was to clear the land well enough to be able to grow cotton. And because of the flooding of the Mississippi River floodplain every year, the land was extremely fertile. Cotton grew to twice the height that it did in other parts of the South and made Mississippi, or the white planters of Mississippi, very rich. I think something like one quarter of American exports in 1860 consisted of cotton being shipped, especially to England and to other places in Europe. And this is again a stock photograph showing the result of that backbreaking labor that Black people had to carry out to enrich their white masters. This is the world out of which Thomas came, and this is the world that he escaped around 1890 when he decided to leave the South and to go north. He wound up in Chicago by around 1893. This is a gravure from 1893 of a building that still stands on South Michigan Avenue. It's now Roosevelt University. When it was originally built in 1893, as the heading says, it was the Auditorium Hotel. It was the most sophisticated and fanciest hotel in the country. And that's where Thomas got a job as a waiter. I said that he had worked at a very high level. This gives you a sense of how high indeed a level it was. And he worked in the restaurant. Interestingly enough, you can visit this room in that building, even though it's a university now. This is now the library. But I made a point of going there to see where it was that he worked as a waiter. So simply to suggest that he was beginning to pull himself up by his bootstraps very markedly as soon as he left the South, but of course within the constraints that white society placed on Black people. That's a photograph of him. I think I label it as around 1893. It's hard to say. I found it in an archive. I think it was taken in Paris. Here's another one from the same series. Very handsome man. This one I got from his grandson, whom I was able to find in Paris. Frederick Thomas learned French fluently. There are testimonies to that fact. As he traveled around Europe, working as a waiter and a valet, he picked up a fair amount of German when he worked in Germany. And when he went to Monte Carlo, on his way to Italy to learn Italian, he worked at the Hotel de Paris, which still exists and which is still a very fancy place directly facing the casino. And that is where, according to various forms of evidence, he caught the eye of a prominent Russian What level of Russian this was is not clear. Sometimes Thomas said it was a Grand Duke, sometimes simply that it was a rich Russian. In any event, meeting the Russian is what resulted in Thomas's decision to go to Russia as the man's valet. He spent some time in St. Petersburg, but then chose to go to Moscow. And this is a contemporaneous, roughly circa 1900 view of Moscow. You can see that it was a low-lying city, not very many tall buildings. The tallest buildings are related to church towers and so on. You can see the cathedrals of the Kremlin in the top center and the spires of the Kremlin towers as well. This is a closer view of the Kremlin at the time. From the other side of the river, you can see St. Basil's Cathedral, of course, the iconic landmark of the city. And this is a famous street that still exists, Petrovka in central Moscow. Again, giving you a sense of what the city looked like. Two or three story buildings for the most part. I think there was one 6 or 7 story building in the center at the time. The highest buildings were churches. Churches were absolutely everywhere throughout the city. And they added very much to the city's soundscape, which I tried to describe in the book as well. So Thomas, as I said, began to work as a waiter, worked his way up to the role of valet. And this is a photograph of the place where he was an assistant, excuse me, to the famous owner, Alexei Sudakov. This is the Yar restaurant as it was rebuilt by Sudakov. In those days, when you went out and you arrived at a place where you would eat and drink well and enjoy entertainment, you wanted to feel you arrived someplace significant. And so these enormously tall ceilings and windows with all kinds of architectural detail was meant to signify, and you can see what the scale is by seeing the pedestrians in the street, that you had in fact arrived someplace quite grand. And that's where Thomas really made his mark and made his money, which resulted in his teaming up with the two Russians that I mentioned. I love this photograph because of the Barzoi. One is surnamed Martynov, the other Tsarev. When my book came out, I should mention in passing, two people in Moscow whose families had connections to Thomas a century earlier wrote to me. One of them was a descendant of Tsarev, the fellow on the extreme left, who sent me this photograph, which for the last 100 years they had preserved in the family and allowed me to reproduce it. He said, the descendant of Thomas's partner, that they had other papers pertaining to their ancestors' partnership with Thomas, but during the police terror of the 1930s, 40s, and at other times in the Soviet Union, out of fear that their apartment might be searched and the papers might seem to be compromising, they burned them all. So this is all that's left, but it's a wonderful photograph. It shows Thomas and his two partners on the grounds of the aquarium, just around the time they were beginning to open it for the first season. This is a postcard that shows what the aquarium garden looked like. Again, grandeur. When you pulled up in your automobile or carriage, you needed to feel that you had arrived someplace extraordinary. And that's what this stone arcade at the entrance was meant to suggest to those who arrived. There are all kinds of buildings and pavilions on the park-like grounds, places where you could go eat and drink, of course, places where you could see shows, vaudeville, operettas, light farcical plays, places where you could go bowling, places where you could even throw spears at targets, all kinds of things. And it was an extremely popular kind of a venue for Muscovites. There were gardens of this sort throughout Europe at the beginning of the 20th century. Tivoli in Copenhagen may be one of the last to survive, but they were absolutely ubiquitous. And Thomas and his partners made it into a great success. It's interesting that in the journals that I mentioned that I went through in Moscow, the theatrical journals, the administration of the aquarium garden was routinely referred to as Thomas and Company, suggesting that he had taken on a much more leading and prominent role than his two Russian partners. I mentioned that after the success of Aquarium, he opened a place of his own, which he renamed Maxim. There was a Maxim in every city in Europe at the time, named after the famous one in Paris. And this is simply a full-page advertisement in a theatrical journal with his photograph, listing the variety acts that were going to be appearing on stage. Everything from gypsy choirs, which were very popular, to number five on the list, a Black American or Negro trio, as it says in the Russian, named Philadelphie. I'm not sure if that's meant to be Philadelphia or Philadelphia or something like that, but it was an international array of acts that would perform on the Russian vaudeville stages and especially in Maxim. What was Maxim like inside? This is an artist's impression of Maxim that I found in a famous Russian journal of the time, Stolitsa i Usadzba, for those of you who may have heard of it, that simply shows a kind of a idealized view of the interior of the Maxim nightclub. There is a couple doing a Spanish dance. There are red jacketed musicians in the upper right, and there are well-heeled patrons enjoying chilled champagne and the rest in tables watching the show. So it was a nightclub, and it was also very successful. A photograph of Thomas with his family. Thomas is obviously in the middle in the back. The woman on the left in the middle is his second wife, Valentina, known as Vali. The three lovely children are his children by his first wife, who died of pneumonia, as a result of which he married unhappily, as it turned out, that woman who is smiling in the picture. I've never been able to pin down exactly who the two men are, but my guess is that they must be relatives of Vali's or friends of Thomas's. I simply was not able to figure that out. But the children are very handsome, and although I wasn't able to find a photograph anywhere, at least not yet, of his first wife, one can infer that she must have been a good-looking woman based on the children. Then Thomas began to stray. He had a mistress, a woman who then became his wife. She also appeared in more demure guises. It wasn't always in leotards. A German singer and dancer by the name of Elvira Jungmann. There were a lot of Germans in Russia before the First World War. She became his loyal wife after he divorced his second wife and went into exile with him. She was well enough known in Germany for these kinds of collector's postcards to have been printed. One of the most interesting things that Thomas did when he was in Moscow at the peak of his success was to try to import Jack Johnson, the famous American Black heavyweight boxing champion, to Russia to put on exhibition matches. Boxing was not really known in Russia at the time. They had Greco-Roman wrestling, but unlike Western Europe or the United States, where boxing was extremely popular, boxing was hardly known. Thomas got in touch with Johnson, who was being hounded in Chicago for racial reasons, and sent him money and tickets to come to Russia. Thomas, I think, was planning to install boxing as a spectator sport in the Russian Empire. And you might very well have succeeded were it not for the fact that this was all supposed to begin, as it says on the right-hand margin, on 15th of July, 1914. And that is according to the old style calendar that was used in Russia at the time, which was 13 days behind the Western calendar used in Europe, which means that this was the very end of July and the World War that became number one, then the Great War, broke out a few days later. So Johnson was never able to come, or he was able to come, but not to put on any of his exhibition matches, and Thomas's plans fell apart. When the war began, there was a lot of xenophobia in the Russian Empire. Thomas decided for various reasons that he was going to become a Russian citizen. This is a document from 1915, 2nd of May, 1915, in which in blue pencil in the upper left-hand corner, Emperor Nicholas II wrote agreed, or I agree. This was part of a petition where Thomas and about 128 other people were received into Russian citizenship, or more accurately became subjects of the Russian Empire. Thomas may very well have been the first Black American to become a subject of the Russian Empire, as far as I've been able to ascertain. This is Thomas. These are photographs that were sent to me by the descendants of one of his business partners that also had been kept in secret for years. They also very generously let me share them, showing Thomas looking very prosperous in two studio photographs from about 1915. Well, as I mentioned, the Bolsheviks didn't take at all kindly to Thomas or to people of his ilk, and Thomas fled to the south. He had property in Odessa, and these are the famous Richelieu steps, a landmark in the city that exists to this day, made famous also by Eisenstein in one of his movies, from which Thomas had to escape by sea. I found an image of the boat that he left on in 1919, the Emperor Nicholas I, a boat designed to house perhaps 350 passengers in comfort, but which of course was completely overcrowded with fleeing refugees who had to submit to absolutely hellish conditions. I mentioned some of them in the book in terms of hygiene and abuse by the crew. The destination was Constantinople, as Russians called it then. This is the old part of the city. Actually, it looks pretty much the same to this day. The skyline dominated with the giant domes and minarets of famous mosques. But Thomas settled and spent his time building up his businesses in the western part of the city, then known as Pera, now as Beyoğlu. It was Western in architecture and in orientation. It's where the foreign embassies were. It's where the Western style restaurants were. And it's where thousands of foreigners came in 1918, British, French, Italian, and Americans, when Constantinople was occupied by the victorious Allies. And that's where Thomas started up his nightclubs. This is an artist's impression of an outdoor entertainment garden of the kind that Thomas began with. It was like a small-scale version of his aquarium in Moscow. I haven't been able to find photographs, but this is the next best thing. In the upper right is a stage with a skimpily dressed dancer performing. On the left is a band shell with musicians. And in the foreground, with their backs to us, are civilians and military watching the show. You can see from the style of clothing that the men are wearing that they appear to be the military from different armies, which was the case. Thomas allied himself with the British. This is an advertisement from a British-run newspaper published in English in Constantinople in 1920 and later, called the Black Sea News, where Thomas proudly announces the fact that he has been given special permission by the British administration in the city for British officers and their families to come to his establishment to dance every day. Some of the places in Constantinople were too questionable to be permissible. He also brought jazz to Constantinople, and he mentions a jazz band that will be performing at his establishment. This is a photograph from documents I found in the National Archives in College Park of his wife, Elvira, and his oldest son, Mikhail, or Michael, just to show you what these people looked like in civilian life. These are his two sons, by Elvira, Bruce and Frederick Jr., who were little and who lived, of course, with the family in Constantinople. Thomas turned to the Americans repeatedly for help. They refused to help him. In 1923, the Turkish Republic was proclaimed. The Ottoman Empire ended. foreigners began to be treated very differently under the Republic than they had been under the Ottomans. Thomas tried to seek protection from Turkish laws from the Americans. They refused him, as a result of which he lost his businesses that he had built up. He lost all of his money, and he was actually put in prison for his debts. In prison, he contracted pneumonia. He had it before, and he died in 1928. He was released from prison into the care of Catholic nuns in the city in whose care he died. And then because of that connection, he was given a funeral service in the Catholic Cathedral in Istanbul, which also exists, and buried in the French Catholic Cemetery in Fariköy. However, there was no money for a grave. So he's here somewhere, but although the record of the cemetery indicates a burial, it does not say where. I have plans with people that I know to put up a plaque on the cemetery wall to commemorate his death burial in Istanbul. So what happened to his nightclub in Istanbul? When I visited in 2009, the space, as you can see from the ceiling, which had been lavishly decorated, had been transformed into a squalid parking garage by virtue of the fact that the building was on a slope, the walls could be torn out, and cars could pull in from the street. Now even this is gone because a fancy new Sofitel hotel has been put up on the site without any commemoration of Thomas. But there are Turkish jazz aficionados in Istanbul who have ideas about how to perhaps change this. Now, I mentioned that Thomas had been married to his second wife, that the marriage did not go well. When I finished writing my book and it was published, one of the descendants in Moscow of Thomas's partners sent me some information that I did not know at the time that I wrote the book, namely that Thomas had an affair with a woman from a wealthy merchant family whose last name was Arkhipov. And the result was a girl who was born in 1914 named Lydia. And that is Lydia on the left. Thomas had little to do with her, according to family lore, but she was raised by her mother's family. And Thomas's memory was cherished in that family. The young girl grew up in the Soviet Union in the Arkhipov family after Thomas left for the south of Russia and then for Constantinople and became a well-known artist. And that's a picture of her as an adult from a poster of an exhibit of her paintings that by coincidence was shown in Moscow quite recently, just a couple of weeks ago. Lydia Fyodorovna Arkhipova. This is one of her paintings, which for obvious reasons I love, apart from its colorful and sort of amusing images, it has a picture of Thomas. So the way I read it is that the little girl on the right looking at us is actually Lydia herself with her mother. And she imagines Thomas and his wife, who by then would have been Elvira and not Vali, at a Russian Paschal table, an Easter table, with a pyramidal sirnaya pascha, a kind of dessert that's made at Easter out of farmer's cheese, and a round cylindrical loaf known as a kulich. And in the background, on the right and on the left, you can see what look like church buildings. The image of Thomas, of course, comes from one of his photographs that she copied because she was too little to remember him. And the descendant who sent me information about her said that there was nothing that she remembered about him that could be passed on. Lovely painting that was at the exhibit. And this is a self-portrait by Lydia Fyodorovna Arkhipova, who was successful in Soviet Russia, died in 1987, but who probably knew nothing about her father. Everything that I've told you about him after he left Moscow in 1918 was probably completely unknown to her. Why do I say that? because Thomas was forgotten everywhere when he died in Istanbul in 1928. There was one brief mention of his death in the New York Times, and after that, virtually nothing, until I was able to scrape together the information that I did in the various countries and archives that I visited. So that's a very brief overview of the life of this remarkable man. I'm glad to have been able to share these images with you, and I'm very happy to answer any questions that anybody may have. So,
hello, everyone. I think, thank you so much, Vladimir. I think you are, you know, you've been very thorough in your presentation. So I think a lot of our questions have been answered as we go. I personally have a question for you. It seems, now this book was released in 2013, is that correct?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And it sounds like there has been this life that has happened after you released the book. Family members reached out to you, you learned more. How is Thomas still living for you today? Are you still researching and finding things out about Frederick Thomas and his family?
A little bit, all connected with this daughter that I didn't know about, because I know that there was a collector of her art. I found out by accident that the show of her paintings from this man's collection was being shown in a central Moscow museum recently. I found on the museum's website a brief overview of her life and a reference to my book as being a source of information about the father. But there's not a lot about her that I know, and I don't know if it's even going to be possible to learn much more about her. I mean, she's a very interesting person in her own right, but since my primary focus was her father, I'm not sure if I'm going to pursue that. Mm-hmm. Who knows? You know, I still hope that maybe somebody in the depths of Mississippi will find a cigar box in the attic that has letters from Thomas when he was in Paris or Moscow to the family members that are left. You know, it's possible. It's possible that somebody else in Russia will emerge. Maybe in Istanbul. The book has been translated into Russian. It's been translated into Turkish and into Japanese of all things, but you know, that's not because of any connection with Thomas. So maybe as word spreads slowly, the Turkish and Russian translations are only a couple of years old, maybe something else will emerge. Another thing that I enjoy mentioning, because it's a fantasy come true, is that the afterlife of Thomas may include a TV series. It's in the works. As I always say, many books are called to the screen and very few ever make it to the screen. But in my case, the evidence is very encouraging that the book may be made into a TV series. It would be done in English and other foreign languages as relevant, you know, Russian, Turkish, and so on. And fingers crossed.
Which would be really exciting. And it's got every element that we'd all want in a TV series, I think.
Yeah. Well, there are questions here that maybe I can
answer. Yeah, exactly. There's a bunch of questions have popped up. I see a number of questions about any living descendants.
Yeah. So yes, now I did talk to Henry Louis Gates about my book. He even blogged about it. And then he included an essay that he wrote about my book in a collection of his essays. So we've talked about that. What happened to Thomas's other children? The boy that I showed a photograph of next to Elvira, Mikhail, is the one whose life ended more or less happily. It was complicated. He left Constantinople, studied in Prague, which the children of Russian emigres were allowed to do by the Russophilic Czech government, worked in South America, participated in the resistance during the war, and then after the war, played scores of small roles in French movies and TV series with some very big stars like William Holden, Audrey Hepburn, and so on. It's his son that I met in Paris when I was doing my research. A very welcoming man who told me a completely different version of his father's life than the one I had discovered in documents. The other children had tragic lives. The youngest daughter wound up committing suicide. I lost track of the oldest daughter. The two young sons were left in Constantinople. I had a very difficult time of it because of the xenophobia of the new Turkish Republican government. Both eventually made it to the United States after the Second World War and did not have successful lives here as far as I could ascertain. I mention all of this in as much detail as I was able to gather in my book, but I don't want to go on too much longer. When he died in debtor's prison, where were his three children? They were taken in by an employee of his who acted as kind of a surrogate father to them and tried to help them as best he could. I actually wrote to the nuns at the nunnery in Istanbul, which still exists there, but all of the records they told me that may have existed in Constantinople in the early 1920s were transferred to France. And so I went to the archive in France where those could have been and found nothing pertaining to Thomas's stay in their charitable hospital, but did find other documents pertaining to Thomas's dealing with French authorities. So it was certainly a useful trip to have made. Did your research include any information on Thomas's family in Mississippi? Yes, as much as I could gather. It's hard to trace the lives of slaves or former slaves, but since they were extraordinary people in being able to buy a farm and to succeed as farmers, there was a paper trail that I found in Cahoma County's archives. And then of course, given the fact that they were Black people and successful, they got into trouble when Reconstruction ended. And I detail that in quite a bit of detail in my book as well. Why was there so much resistance to Thomas from the US? For purely racist reasons. Let me give you one concrete example because I don't want to, you know, I could go on for three more hours, but I'm going to resist. Thomas had to conceal from the American authorities in Constantinople that he had taken on Russian imperial citizenship. You could not be a dual citizen in those days. So when he came to the American consulate general, he lied. And he said that my papers were stolen from me in Bolshevik Russia, but I'm an American. And given the way he looked and sounded, it was clear to everybody that he was a Black man from the American South. So he wanted a passport so he could travel. And they said, well, we're gonna have to check your records in the State Department in DC to see whether or not you really are an American. And so they dragged the process out, and the statement from the State Department that came back, which I found in an archive, is that no, we have no records of Thomas ever having been an American. And that's a lie, because when I went to those same archives and looked for records 85 plus years later, I found dozens of them. So they either didn't bother to look because they were dealing with a Black man who had a white wife and mixed race children and had been rich and famous and didn't want to help him, or they didn't bother to look. Later on, when he was already dead and his sons tried to get help from the Americans, the climate at the State Department had changed. They recognized that they had mistreated Thomas earlier and they gave the boys a break. So that's a little bit of what characterizes the State Department's attitude toward Thomas and frankly toward other Black people at the time and frankly toward Jews as well, because if you read about the State Department in the 1920s, it was an egregiously anti-Semitic institution. Do I think of Mr. Thomas's life and destiny changing since my book was first published? I'm very happy to have been able to bring him back to public memory. As I said, I'm working with people on commemorating him in Istanbul once the pandemic ends, maybe having a music festival to commemorate his introduction of jazz to Turkey, and certainly trying to arrange with the local Catholic authorities for permission to put up a plaque commemorating the fact that he was buried there. I am afraid that that's as far as my ambitions go in terms of affecting his destiny.
Looks like we have a question about you too, about how many languages do you speak, Vladimir?
Oh, well, I can't claim anything special. I mean, obviously I speak Russian and English. I can function pretty well in French to some extent, in German, but that ends it there.
And Thomas spoke Russian, didn't he?
He did. There is one reminiscence of it that I found, which is very interesting, which suggests that he could speak it glibly, but with lots of grammatical mistakes. But what helped him enormously is that throughout the world at the time that he was active, the second language everywhere was French. Now it's English. Everybody speaks English or tries to. In those days, it was French. He learned it very well. I found evidence of that fact. So it would help him considerably in Russia and especially in Turkey. He never learned very much Turkish, but French was almost officially the second language of the Ottoman Empire, to such an extent that when the empire ended and the Republic began, the Republic proclaimed that business had to be conducted in Turkish and no longer in French. So with his flawed but functional Russian and his French, and some German, he was able to succeed very well in Moscow business life, to the extent that he was actually inducted into a guild of merchants of the first guild, which was a prestigious position to be in Moscow, just on the eve of the revolution.
Mm-hmm. Well, look at the questions are just coming in. Thank you, everyone. We are going to 12:15 today. So if you can stay with us, that's great. We'll keep answering questions, won't we, Vladimir?
Sure. Did he hire American jazz musicians? Americans and Europeans as well. I tried to trace the names of the performers and the bands that I could find in his advertisements when he was in Constantinople and in Moscow. Most of them have left no record. But one of the performers, did. Now, his name, of course, escapes me at the moment. But if any of you are fans of Downton Abbey, there is an episode when a very suave black musician is on the verge of having an affair with one of the young women attached to the Downton Abbey family. Anyway, Jack Ross, thank you very much, CGR. So Jack Ross was modeled on the actual historical figure who performed in Thomas's nightclub, the Maxim in Constantinople, and then went on to a very successful career as a kind of a jazz singer and musician. There are even YouTube videos of him. Very suave, very wonderful performer in London, where it is even rumored that he had an affair with Lady Mountbatten, so his star kept climbing in a sense. I wish I could remember the actual person's name, but it's retrievable.
There's a question about getting a sense of Thomas's personality and yes. How he succeeded so well.
Oh, well, it was a combination of things. For one thing, I did find letters that he wrote. When he was trying to answer various accusations that were made against him by merchants in Constantinople when he had financial difficulties or when the American diplomats were giving him a hard time. So you got a sense of his voice there. There were reminiscences of him by Russians, by visiting performers. In Constantinople in particular, the senior American in the city, Admiral Mark Bristol, who was both the top military commander and the American High Commissioner, like the ambassador of the United States to the late Ottoman and subsequently the Turkish Republic, he took an interest in Thomas's plight and tried to help him. And he got an American reporter to go around and ask people what they thought of Thomas, because racist tongues began to wag in Constantinople that Thomas was taking advantage of his waitresses. And what came back in a letter that the reporter wrote to the admiral, which I found in an archive, is that Thomas is exactly the opposite of how his naysayers are trying to portray him. He's a very kind employer. He puts on special benefit performances to benefit the waitresses. And using the racist terminology of the time, the reporter says he's considered to be among the whitest employers in Constantinople, if you understand the reversal that that implies. Mm-hmm. So there were enough of these kinds of responses to get a sense of him. And also I mentioned that I found documents about him in French archives where he emerged as a very wily character. The French copyright agency wanted him to pay royalties on French music that he was having his musicians play in Moscow. Thomas didn't want to pay him. And the letters that were preserved in the archive are a wonderful record of Thomas's cunning evasion of attempts to pay any fees, in which he was simply doing what every other Russian entrepreneur was doing at the time. I mean, who's going to want to pay copyright fees if you can avoid doing it, especially when the whole issue of international copyrights was just coming into play and it wasn't being taken very seriously. So between one thing and another, it was possible to get a sense of him. Mm-hmm. Now, I've dreamt of him a couple of times, but he's always mute.
Interesting.
he never says anything to me.
Is there anything that, like a nugget that you were really looking to find out about Thomas that you just haven't been able to discover yet?
Yes, a very central one, actually. What did he really think of becoming a Russian citizen or subject? Now, mm-hmm. It's clear that he became himself in Russia because he became very successful financially, and for that matter, personally, in Russia, which is why I called the Black Russian the book and not the Turkish Russian, for example, because he came to his potential in Russia. And it was obviously a place where he could be financially and practically very successful. But did he feel any kind of a real tie to the place? Or was it merely the place where he could successfully, as it were, hang his hat? I'm guessing probably he did feel an attachment. I don't think you can have a life in a place like that for as long as he did. He lived in Moscow longer than anywhere else except on the family farm in Mississippi. I don't think you can do that without getting some attachment.
I would personally agree with that. I think we're coming toward the end of our time here together. I think I echo all of the other people who've been chiming in. Thank you so much for bringing this man's life to all of our attention and coloring it so beautifully. What an interesting journey through different systems, different realities, different cultures in such an interesting time. I want to, first of all, thank Masha as well. Masha, do you have any final questions or remarks for Vladimir before we say goodbye?
Well, I would like to thank Vladimir for all the research, all the hard work that he's done bringing this historical figure to life. And especially, you know, Russia has been portrayed not in a really very positive light in media in the West traditionally. Well, every once in a while, worse than at other times. And just showing the life journey of that person, the Black person from American South through Russia, through the Russian Empire, and becoming very successful, and just emphasizing that the people that surrounded him were, you know, colorblind. They did not look at him as a Black person. They looked at him as, you know, a fellow businessman or a friend. And also I remember a passage from the book where Vladimir writes about the reviews in Russian media, in press and publications, where journalists and reporters would talk about him, but would never even think about mentioning his color, and just talking about, you know, his business and whatever he was doing, and completely not seeing that he was a Black person. It was not important. They didn't even, you know, ever pay attention to that, while there were so many other things to talk about. So that's really, that was really very rewarding to read in this book. Also, it's interesting talking about Frederick Thomas, that he actually made an attempt to survive in Soviet Russia, and he approached the Council of Soldiers in Moscow with a proposal to create some kind of a revolutionary theater.
But this is
I'm sure he would have prospered in the 1920s.
But this was with the provisional government.
Yeah, yeah. But he approached the Soviet.
They had Sovieti of soldiers and so on with the provisional government as well. They weren't necessarily Bolshevik. That was simply the new institution. So if Russia had not suffered the Bolshevik coup in October, if it had simply been the February Revolution and the provisional government had managed to hold elections and so on, Thomas wouldn't have left, because he would have found a niche for himself. The Bolsheviks were the racists. They were basically like American racists are toward Blacks. The Bolsheviks were toward classes. And there was nothing Thomas could do to ingratiate himself with them. He had grand plans. I think his original idea in bringing Jack Johnson, the heavyweight champion, from the United States to Russia, when Jack Johnson was running into all kinds of trouble of a purely racist sort, was to perhaps have Jack Johnson work with him on opening up places in Russia, because Jack Johnson was an entrepreneur as well. He had a nightclub in Chicago. I think they could have worked together. It could have been an entertainment empire had it not been for October.
Yeah, I agree. I see a future for Frederick Thomas, even in the 1920s in Soviet Russia. He would have been successful.
Well, you know, he said that he left because he knew, he found out from a friend that his name was on a list of those to be arrested. And revolutionary justice, as the Bolsheviks liked to call it, consisted often in those early months of some local Chekist taking the person to the back and shooting him. Thomas didn't want to risk it.
We know for
a fact that he would not have survived 1937.
That's very true. That's my thought exactly. Even if he were to be successful in the 1920s with his ideas of a new theater, in the 1930s, that would have been the end of him, because he was a foreigner. And it was his, his vision of the future, his, in a way, the sense of where history was going, that saved him, at least from that. Yeah. Well, thank you so much for the fascinating talk and the book.
Thank you. I enjoyed talking with you about it. I enjoyed talking to everyone else. Thank you for hosting me.
What a pleasure. Thank you so much. And I'd also like to take the opportunity to once again thank St. Paul Jewish Federation and RAJMN for supporting this program with the Museum of Russian Art. Vladimir's book, The Black Russian, is available in our beautiful gift shop. You can shop online at shoptomora.org, or you can stop in. We'd love to see you. We are open and a safe place to be. We'll be celebrating a virtual grand opening and an unveiling of our three new exhibitions on March 2nd. You can check our website out for that information. And thank you to all of you who are participating in our virtual programming. We are just so pleased to be able to reach you all from all over the country and all over the world. And we hope, if you're local and when you're able, you can come and visit us in our galleries. And we can't wait until you can come to Minneapolis, Vladimir.
I'm looking forward to it, yes.
You stay safe and take care of yourself and everyone. We will hopefully see you soon. Take care. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.